يا أيها الذين آمنوا استعينوا
يا أيها الذين آمنوا ادخلوا في السلم
يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا
يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praises and thanks are due to Allah. We ask His help and forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our souls and our bad deeds. Whomever Allah guides, no one can lead him astray, and whomever Allah leads astray, no one can guide him. I bear witness that there is no God to be worshipped except Allah alone, and I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his last messenger and his servant. Dear respected brothers and sisters, today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to discuss verse 183 from Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the theme of fasting. Also, we're trying to cover part of verse 184 because it's talking about some very important issues related to fasting and some fiqh issues. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll talk about them as well. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about fasting? How can I understand fasting? How can I properly implement fasting? What are the main principles of fasting that I need to maintain for my fasting to be accepted? What are the actions that I need to do for my fasting to be perfect? And what are some of the actions that I need to avoid? Otherwise, they're going to nullify my fasting if I did them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. All you who have believed, fasting, siyam, is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for some nations before you, so perhaps you might become mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You might become God's fearing, having taqwa towards Allah. I would like at the beginning to explain the meaning of fasting and then make this connection between fasting and sabr. Fasting in Arabic language, it means al-imsak, to hold into something or to restrain something. For example, if I'm sitting in this position and I don't move right or left because I'm giving this presentation or this episode where I'm sitting down, now I'm making something called imsak, or I'm doing something that is called suyam because I'm not moving. For example, if I'm not talking to anyone around me, that's also called suyam because I'm restraining my tongue inside of my mouth and not talking. Sayyidah Maryam alayhi salam, she said, إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لِلرَّحْمَانِ صَوْمًا. I have made a vow between me and Allah the Almighty. I have promised Allah the Almighty to not talk to anyone, and that is the way that I express my fasting, my siyam. So she expressed her fasting by not talking to anyone to fulfill her vow that she made with Allah, the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now fasting from the Arabic language perspective means to restrain something. You know, sometimes if you have the weather is a little bit humid and there is no wind whatsoever, you're not feeling any air in the weather, we call this also الرياحُ صائمه. الرياح, the wind is actually making some fasting today by not moving at all. So that is the meaning of fasting. And we have a very strong connection between the meaning of siyam and the meaning of sabr as well. We talked in some previous episodes about the importance of sabr in our religion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, when he talked about the two main things that we need to seek help in or to seek comfort in when we have some challenges in life. He said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. He said you need to seek some aid or some support in two things, as-sabr and as-salah. And we said sabr means is to restrain your desires that might deviate you from doing what you have to do and to do what's right no matter what, regardless of the circumstances around you, regardless of what people say, regardless of how you feel. You just do what you need to do. When you get up in the morning and you go to work, regardless of how you feel, even if you want to sleep for longer, you have to go to work. That's called fasting, because you're restraining your desires and just to get up and to go to work. That's also perseverance. You know, so the idea of fasting is very close to the idea of sabr, or sabr can be translated as perseverance, it can be translated as patience, for example, it can be translated as commitment, it can be also translated as steadfastness, right? So you cannot fast, you cannot fulfill fasting in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes unless you have patience or sabr in the first place. In fact, you cannot even achieve anything in this life or in the hereafter without having fasting first. That quality of perseverance, of commitment, steadfastness, doing what I have to do no matter what, regardless of what's going on around me, that is the main quality that every single human being, whether he's a believer or not, has to have to achieve any kind of success, worldly success or any kind of success that has to do with the hereafter as well. That is the meaning of fasting from the linguistic perspective, because we said we're going to focus a little bit on the linguistic of the verses. When it comes to the shara'i meaning, the meaning of fasting in Islam, al-Imam al-Alusi rahimahullah, for example, when he talked about the definition of fasting, he gave the definition of the fuqaha, the jurists, the scholars of Islamic jurisprudence. He said, هو إمساك عن أشياء مخصوصة, that you restrain yourself from certain things, على وجه مخصوص, in a certain way, في زمان مخصوص, during a certain time, في زمان مخصوص من أناس مخصوصين, and only some certain people have to do that, who are the believers or the Muslims in the first place, because other than Muslims are not actually requested to fast in the first place. And the scholars of fiqh, when they define the word fasting, they say al-imsak, it's to restrain or to abstain from two things, عن شهوتي البطن والفرج, abstain from the two main desires that every human being has in this world. What are these two main desires? The stomach and the genitals. So you stay away from eating, drinking, or having your intimacy with your spouse in marriage, of course. You restrain from these two main desires, from طلوع الفجر, from the dawn time, from fajr time, إلى غروب الشمس, until the sunset, from the dawn until the sunset, from Maghrib until, or from Fajr until Maghrib prayer. So this is the definition of fasting. And from the definition, we can extract the two main pillars of fasting. We only have two pillars of fasting. The first pillar is what we have been talking about, to abstain from these two desires. And the second pillar of fasting is actually your intention. What I mean by this is that if I wake up in the morning and I don't eat anything until Maghrib prayer, but I didn't have the intention of fasting, that doesn't count as fasting. For example, I woke up today and I didn't find food at home, or I was very busy, so I went to work without eating anything, and then I stayed at work until Maghrib prayer. By the time I went home, it was Maghrib time. I didn't eat anything, I haven't had anything to drink, right? But I did not have the intention. Now that is not fasting for you, unless you had the intention at any point during the day. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do sometimes when he comes to his family and he asks if they have some food, he would eat. But if they wouldn't have any food, he would say, I'm fasting today, because he did that before the sunset sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about fasting, he's telling us because of the importance of this ibadah, not only Muslims in this nation have to fast, but all other previous nations, they also had to fast. And that's why Allah said, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبِلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Siyam or fasting is prescribed for you as it was prescribed for nations before you. And now there's a lot of benefits in this expression from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first benefit is that Allah azza wa jal is telling us that this is one of the most important ibadat, because siyam adds a lot to our personalities. Siyam can diminish or demolish this idea of ego that we have inside of us. Sometimes we feel arrogant. Sometimes if we have a good job, we feel that we're wealthy, that we're arrogant, we are better than other people. But when you're fasting, you're not eating or drinking anything, you compare yourself to the least fortunate people and you humble yourself towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us cannot have this quality of humbling themselves and feeling their weakness compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without fasting. Fasting is also there to train us to have this commitment every single day, regardless of how tired I am. Of course, if I'm sick, it's a different issue that I'm going to talk about now. If I'm traveling, for example, that's a different issue. I can be exempt that I don't have to fast from the Islamic law perspective, the fiqh perspective. But if I'm just tired throughout the day, but I can continue fasting, I need to have this commitment. So Siyam teaches us, especially our youth, that life is a challenge. You don't get all what you want. You know, nowadays people get very mad when the internet is a little bit slow, but in the past, at the beginning, when we had computers or internet at the beginning, people didn't even think about the speed of the internet then. But now people, if the internet is a little bit slow, they get upset at each other because they get all what you want. But fasting teaches you that you don't get all what you want. You have to improve that quality inside of you. Another benefit that we can get from this verse is Allah is making this ibadah or this kind of worship easy for us when He tells us also previous nations had to do the same thing. Look, Muslims, you're not the only people who had to fast, everybody else. So there is an example that we have to follow here. And that makes things easy for us. When, for example, throughout the pandemic that we're going through right now in COVID-19, when you see everybody else all over the world, in every single country, people are struggling, that makes things easier for you. But if you have the pandemic only in one country, or you have that disease in only one country, that would have been harder for people. So also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, Muslims, you need to have this sense of competition when it comes to ibadah, because you and all other nations have to fast. Inshallah, we'll talk about this concept after our short break. Please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to the second half of our episode. We're still discussing verse 182 in Surah Al-Baqarah, in which Allah is talking about fasting. And we're talking about this comparison that Allah made between us Muslims and previous nations when He said all of you have to fast. And we said Allah is telling us this to make it easy for us. Not only us has to fast, but all previous nations. But in which way did they used to fast? We don't know. Allah did not tell us exactly how they used to do it. Another benefit that scholars mention here is that feeling of competition. We need to feel that we're competing when it comes to any kind of worship. All of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. There are some people are the foremost, the most successful people, the closest people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are some people are going to be at the end of the list. They're going to be lining up at the end of the row or at the end of the queue. You don't want to be at the end of the queue when you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to be competing. So Muslims, everybody's fasting. You need to be in the forefront, inshallah, azza wa jal. Also, Allah Azza wa Jal is making fasting for us only for a fixed number of days. It's not for a lot of months, for example, it's only for 1 month, which is the month of Ramadan. Allah says in ayah number 184, which is the next ayah, Allah says number 184, He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, in number 184, Allah says أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ, it's prescribed for you only for a few number of days, just fixed days, only in the month of Ramadan, unless someone has to make up fasting or he has to fast for the vow that he couldn't fulfill, for example. These are different occasions. But in general, there are very few days throughout the year that you need to fast. So Allah is making things easy for us. So what I'm going to achieve if I can fast, if I can restrain my desires, my stomach and genitals, if I can control myself during fasting, if I can improve that quality of humbleness towards Allah, what I'm going to get out of this? Allah said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to help you to develop that idea or that quality of taqwa. And as we said before, taqwa is the most or one of the most repeated qualities in the Quran. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam even himself, he used to repeat that instruction every single Friday in his khutbah. At the introduction of his khutbah that we call khutbatul haja, he used to speak about taqwa and mention some of the verses of the Quran that speak about taqwa. The Prophet ﷺ said, "As-siyamu junnah." Junnah means protection. As-siyamu junnah, and that's why we call the infant or the baby in his mother's womb, the infant, we call him janin. Janin because he is protected in his mother's womb. So the fasting is also a junnah. Junnah means it's a protection for you from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's actually the idea of junnah, or the idea of protection, is the same meaning of taqwa. Because taqwa is to have a barrier or a protection between yourself and whatever is prohibited, whatever displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this connection between fasting, between sabr, patience, perseverance, and taqwa, being mindful of Allah or protecting yourself from disobeying, is something that we need to point out when we speak about this verse. Siyam, fasting, and taqwa. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us all these qualities. And even Rasulullah, peace be upon him, when he talked to the youth about fasting, he said the same thing, and he used the same exact theme. He said, Ya ma'shar al-shabab, O youth, man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. Whoever amongst you can get married, let him get married immediately if he has the capacity and the ability to get married. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَعَلَيْهِ بِالصَّوْمِ. But if you cannot fast, if you cannot get married because you don't have a financial ability or the physical ability, for example, فَعَلَيْهِ بِالصَّوْمِ, you need to start fasting, practice fasting because of what? فَإِنَّهُ لَهُ وِجَاءَ. Wujah means also protection. He is going to protect you from the fitnas around you. Very important idea to focus on here. Now the next ayah, which is ayah number 184, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about fiqh issues that are related to fasting. For example, he said, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ after أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ, it's for fixed number of days. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخْرٍ. And if one of you is sick, or one of you is on a journey, meaning he's traveling, he's not staying in his country or in his city or with his family, he's traveling, now he is allowed to break his fast, but he needs to make up his fasting later on. And now when it comes to this issue, that's a lot of, that's one of the most repeated, frequently repeated questions by people. They always ask this question, especially in Ramadan. What if I'm fasting? And a lot of people say, nowadays fasting is very comfortable compared to the past. In the past, for example, people used to ride horses or ride camels, for example, to fast, or even sometimes the walk. And at the time of Rasulullah, the Bedouins used to live in the desert. So maybe that's why Allah told them that you're exempt and you can break your fast if you're fasting, if you're traveling. Some people think like that. They're allowed to break their fast if they're traveling because it's so hard for them. But actually, Allah did not say this in the verse. He said, if you're traveling, you're allowed to break your fast. And it means, if you want to break your fast, you break it. But if you don't want to, you can fast. Allah said anyways at the end of this verse, وأن تصوموا خير لكم. Anyways, if you fast, it's always better for you. That's a general statement used by some of the jurists that even if you're traveling, even if you're sick and you think you can make it, you can fast, it's better for you. But if fasting is going to increase your sickness or make it worse or make it so hard for you while traveling, you're not supposed to fast. For example, I'll give an example. In Sahih al-Bukhari, Nabi ﷺ, one time he was traveling with his Sahaba, فَرَأَى رَجُلًا قَدْ ظُلِّلَ عَلَيْهِ. He saw a man very tired, exhausting, he cannot even stand up, and he's sitting down and people are giving him shade. Shade, like he's sitting under a tree, they are giving him shade with their clothes, maybe, or with their bodies, because he cannot even stand up. The Prophet said, what's wrong with him? They said, Ya Rasulullah, he's fasting. We're traveling and he decided to fast, he doesn't want to break his fast, right? So that person, he thinks that now he's doing an extra righteous action and he's going to gain more rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by fasting while traveling, even if he cannot stand up like that. What did Rasulullah say? What was the instruction? He said, لَيْسَ مِنَ الْبِرِّ الصِّيَامُ فِي السَّفَرِ. Fasting while traveling, especially in this particular situation and the similar situations, is not an act of righteousness towards Allah. Don't think that when you make things hard for yourself that you are going to gain more rewards. People, for example, will stand up at night and they cannot recite anything because they are exhausted. Don't think that you're pleasing Allah by doing so. Overwhelming yourself is not one of the goals of this Sharia. Actually, this Sharia is the religion of ease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا فَإِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. With every hardship there is ease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ in Surah Al-Hajj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never intended to place any hardship on you in religion. You know what I'm saying? So it's very important to understand that Allah did not legislate fasting to make it hard for us. In fact, if you cannot fast because you're exempt, you can just break your fast. Let me give you an example. So this companion by the name of Hamza ibn Amr al-Aslami, he came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, asking him, O Messenger of God, I have heard you talking about fasting while traveling and you said it's not an act of righteousness. It's not going to bring you any closer to Allah the Almighty if it's going to cause you some hardship. But أجد مني قوة. I'm a young man, I have some more energy, and you know, nowadays it's very easy to fast because if you're traveling with your car, for example, if you're driving, you can have some snacks, and it's not hot outside because you have the AC inside. If you're on your flight, they bring you meals, and you have even your tea and your coffee. So it's not as hard as it used to be in the past. I have some energy. Can I please fast while I'm traveling? Because I don't want to have to fast after Ramadan is over and make up my fasting in some other days by myself. I want to fast while everyone else is fasting. So am I allowed to do that? The Prophet said, هِيَ رُخْصَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى فَمَنْ أَخَذَ بِهَا فَحَسَنْ وَمَنْ أَحَبَّ أَن يَصُومَ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِ. The Prophet said, this is only a permission from Allah. Allah is giving you permission to make your life easier. If you want to follow this permission and take it and use it, I mean, you can do that. But if you don't want to and you want to fast, that's also permissible. So you can do that. And in another narration from Abi Sa'id and Jabir, may Allah be pleased with them all, he said, or they said, سَافَرْنَا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. We used to travel with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Some of us are fasting, some others are not fasting. وَلَا يُنْكِرُ أَحَدٌ عَلَى أَحَدٌ. And none of them is judging the other. And that is the main point here in this narration. The narration of Abu Sa'id and Jabir, may Allah be pleased with them all. They said that when we traveled with Rasulullah, some of us were able to fast and they did it. Some others were not able to fast, or even if they're able to, but they don't want to. They want to use the permission of Allah, the rukhsa. And none of them would criticize the other. That is the main point when we have any different opinions, especially in Islamic law, and everyone is following one of the recognized scholars or recognized schools of thought would not allow it to fight لا إنكار في مسائل الخلاف. From this narration and the similar narrations, the scholar said لا إنكار في مسائل الخلاف would not allow it to judge or criticize each other when it comes to controversial issues in Islamic law. Another narration, for example, that's mentioned in a book called إحكام الأحكام شرح عمدة الأحكام. عمدة الأحكام is explained by Ibn Daqiq al-Eid in his book إحكام الأحكام. That's one of the most authentic books in Fiqh al-Shafi'i, for example. And إحكام الأحكام is a book of hadith. It's a book of hadith. So he's basically explaining some hadith that are agreed on by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. One of these ahadith that he explained in Kitab al-Siyam, the book of fasting, he narrated through Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu that he said, كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن الصائم. We were traveling with the Prophet, peace be upon him. Some of us are fasting, ومن المفطر, and some others are not fasting. قال فنزلنا منزلا في يوم حار وأكثرنا ظلا صاحب الكساء ومنا من يتقي الشمس بيده. He said, we, you know, basically when you're traveling, you go for a connection between two flights. They also went to have a rest or camp somewhere, but it was too hot on that day. And you can imagine, they are in the desert, Bedouins, رضي الله عنهم, may Allah please with them, and it's too hot and they are camping during the daytime. So it was too hot, and some of them, they had some pieces of cloth that they are trying to have shade with, putting their cloth on top of them, like umbrellas or something. And some others, they have nothing. They don't have umbrellas. They don't have any piece of cloth. So what they did, they tried to protect themselves from the sun with their hands. It's too hot. And then he said, فَسَقَطَ الصُّوَّامِ. The people are fasting. They couldn't handle it. Some of them fell unconscious. Some others, they were extremely exhausted, sleeping the whole day because they insisted to fast while traveling. سَقَطَ الصُّوَّامِ. وَقَامَ الْمُفْطِرُونَ فَضَرَبُوا الْأَبْنِيَةِ. As for people who are not fasting, they went and they set up the tents for us to camp, and they brought the water for people who are fasting to break their fast, and they prepared the meals for us to eat our fast. So when we went to the Prophet ﷺ and we told him that, he said, ذَهَبَ الْمُفْطِرُونَ الْيَوْمَ بِالْأَجْرِ كُلِّ. He said, people who were not fasting on that day, they have taken all the reward of themselves, and by helping other people who are fasting to break their fast and preparing for everyone. Community service in this time, it was better than fasting in the sight of Rasulullah. Inshallah, we'll stop here and we'll continue in another episode with another ayah that starts with Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, all you who have believed. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
يا أيها الذين آمنوا استعينوا
يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب
يا أيها الذين آمنوا ادخلوا في السلم
يا